Last night, Joe Biden and Donald Trump came to Nashville to make their pitch as to why we should elect them to be our president. They were asked many, many questions, but there was a question that really wasn't on the agenda that I think it may be the most important one. And that is the question of our understanding of the role of government in our lives and in the broader society. You see, sometimes we think that having any government or any form of governance or structure is a problem because we've experienced lots of examples of bad government. But the Apostle Paul, in his writing to the church at Rome, seemed to think differently. He wants to argue that government is a good thing, ordained by God, and that we should participate in good governance. Now, I confess, there are times when I'm uncomfortable with this teaching from Paul. And so today I'm writing a letter to Paul, basically asking him about what he was thinking in writing this passage in Romans 13 on being subject to governmental authorities. And I hope that it will start us all thinking about the place of government in our lives. I'm Jay Voorhees, pastor of the City Road Chapel United Methodist Church located in Madison, Tennessee. And the Lord be with you.
This is Prime, the online service of prayer and praise for and from the City Road Chapel United Methodist Church, located in Madison, Tennessee. This service is for October the 25th, 2020.
Let us pray together. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let us sow love. Where there is injury, let us sow pardon. Where there is doubt, let us sow faith. Where there is despair, let us sow hope. Where there is darkness, let us sow light. And where there is sadness, let us sow joy. O Divine Master, grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, and it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it's in dying that we are born to eternal life in Jesus Christ. Amen.
A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, he amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. Were not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. Dost ask who that may be? Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord Sabaoth, his name, from age to age the same. And he must win the battle. That word above all heavenly powers, no thanks to them abideth. The Spirit and the gifts are ours, through him who with us sided. Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also, the body they may kill. God's truth abideth still, His kingdom is forever.
Our act of praise today comes from Psalm 146. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God all my life long. Do not put your trust in princes, in mortals, in whom there is no help. When their breath departs, they return to the earth. On that very day, their plans perish. Happy are those whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God, who made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, who keeps faith forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets prisoners free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over strangers. He upholds the orphan and the widow, but the way of the wicked He brings to ruin. The Lord will reign forever, your God, O Zion, for all generations. Praise the Lord.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Welcome to City Road Chapel United Methodist Church, a community of people dedicated to growing in our love of God and love of neighbor. Located in Madison, Tennessee, for over 170 years, we gather together to worship and learn about God and to share God's love with our neighbors, no matter their background or situation. While we have suspended in-person worship during the COVID epidemic, we are pleased to announce that we will resume our in-person worship services beginning Sunday, October 18th, 2020, at 9 a.m. All coming to that service are asked to comply with our covenant of care found at cityroadchapel.org. Our ministry in Madison includes caring for children and assisting families through our Child Development Center and offering help to the impoverished through a variety of ministries. We believe that we are called to grow both in our love of God and to love our neighbors as Christ loved us. Our ministry is dependent on the generosity of our members and the community. If you would like to make a donation to the work of City Road Chapel, please visit our website at cityroadchapel.org/give. All donations are tax deductible. We hope and pray that you will find meaning in today's service, and we hope that you will continue to join us online or at our Sunday morning worship service very soon. Our scripture for today is from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 13, verses 1 through 10. Every person should place themselves under the authority of the government. There isn't any authority unless it comes from God, and the authorities that are there have been put in place by God. So anyone who opposes the authority is standing against what God has established. People who take this kind of stand will get punished. The authorities don't frighten people who are doing the right thing. Rather, they frighten people who are doing wrong. Would you rather not be afraid of authority? Do what's right and you will receive its approval. It is God's servant given for your benefit. But if you do what's wrong, be afraid because it doesn't have weapons to enforce the law for nothing. It is God's servant put in place to carry out his punishment on those who do what is wrong. That is why it is necessary to place yourself under the government's authority. Not only to avoid God's punishment, but also for the sake of your conscience. You should also pay taxes for the same reason, because the authorities are God's assistants, concerned with this very thing. So pay everyone what you owe them. Pay the taxes you owe, pay the duties you are charged, give respect to those who you should respect, and honor those who you should honor. Don't be in debt to anyone, except for the obligation to love each other. Whoever loves another person has fulfilled the law. The commandments, don't commit adultery, don't murder, don't steal, don't desire what others have, and any other commandments are all summed up in one word. You must love your neighbor as yourself. Love doesn't do anything wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is what fulfills the law. Take a moment to meditate on these words. What do you hear God saying to you today in this word? Dear Paul the Apostle, what are we to do with you? There you were, sitting in Corinth with your friends Priscilla and Aquila, knowing that they had been forced out of their home city of Rome through the machinations of the emperor Claudius. In between making tents, you taught the church there in Corinth that their citizenship was not of this world, but of a new kingdom, the kingdom of God. So much so that the followers of Jesus would rather die than renounce their faith in favor of worshiping the emperor. You are a man who has experienced the wrath of Roman governmental power, and you will very likely be arrested and die at the hands of the current emperor Nero. So how can you, of all people, come out of nowhere and suggest that all should submit to governing authorities? You see, we have a problem. All of this sounds good on the surface, this teaching that folks have used as a call to citizenship throughout the years. Yet when we continue on in the story of Scripture, we discover that Romans 13 is countered by John's vision of governmental power in Revelation 13, a vision in which that power is portrayed as a beast, an evil power that is at odds with the will of God. So who is right? You, Paul, or that prophet on Patmos who will come and scare our pants off later in the story? We have another problem as well. You see, sitting here a couple of thousand years after you wrote your letter to the church at Rome, we find ourselves pretty cynical of our governing authorities. Oh, we love our country and believe that this is a pretty great place to be. It's the leaders and the structures that test our faith and cause us to question your call to submission. We've seen too many charismatic leaders come and go, people who looked good on the surface but who were broken and weak on the inside. Some writer not long ago suggested that absolute power corrupts absolutely, and we found this to be absolutely true. The people behind the government aren't bad, but they're human and subject to all the effects of sin that we all deal with. Over time, as promises have been made and broken again and again, we find ourselves pretty hopeless about the ability of government to accomplish anything. So, Paul, what are we to do with this teaching that tells us to submit to the governing authorities? What were you thinking when you wrote those words, and do they have any meaning for us today? One of the problems we have in reading this teaching is that we fail to understand the situation you were addressing in Rome. You were, after all, trying to help a church rebuild after having been cast out of the city by Claudius because of riots in the streets between Jews and Christians. Even though Christianity had been a Jewish movement, in Rome, Judaism was becoming more nationalistic and revolutionary, with Jewish zealots arguing for the overthrow of the government. These tensions were finding their way into the church as Gentiles and Jews argued over the proper way to think about the Roman Empire. But as you said, Paul, in the previous chapter, Romans 12, the unity of the body of Christ was paramount, and love must be at the center of Christian life and practice. Yes, the empire was oppressive and corrupt, but no matter how corrupt, your kingdom call to love and service reigns supreme. So you counseled the church at Rome to avoid these entanglements, choosing instead to submit to the authorities in pursuit of love and unity. Of course, as you always do, you offered a justification for this suggestion. As a good Jew and man of your times, it was the appeal to order, recognizing that having no authorities in society leads to anarchy. You were a man who believed in the proper order of things, and so it made sense that the government as an institution had been ordained by God to provide order to the world. This ordering doesn't speak to the justice or injustice of any governmental structure. For instance, you don't talk about Nero's policy or his corruption. Rather, it addresses a belief that all communities, be they the church or a city/state, require some sort of structure, some sort of governing authority, and that these authorities should be treated with respect as ordained by God. Yet even though authority must be respected and order maintained, it is clear from the rest of your letter that love is the guiding principle upon which our lives and relations must be built, and that organizations and authorities which harm and oppress others may be called to account. Your teaching presents an idealized view of authority and government. While we live in a world in which that ideal is rarely reached due to the prevalence of sin and brokenness in the world, the fact is that governments are staffed by sinful people in need of your grace, and they often make bad judgments and faulty decisions through their own weaknesses. We are a prideful people who often think that we know much better what to do than God does. So we strike off on our own, believing our own press clippings and doing things that harm others. And in some cases, governments are overwhelmed by persons who are oppressive and perpetuate evil in their sinful pursuit of control and cash. These situations are far removed from the ideal you describe. This is the dilemma that German theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer faced. Bonhoeffer was confronted with evil at its worst in the person of Adolf Hitler, and he struggled to make sense of the call to submit with the call to love, the call to humility with the confronting of evil. Eventually, Bonhoeffer decided that evil was too great and that Hitler must be killed. However, he recognized that act as outside the ideal will of God and something that he would be responsible for throughout the rest of his life. Even in the face of evil, Bonhoeffer recognized that the ultimate goal of the follower of Jesus is the pursuit of love, justice, and righteousness. Martin Luther King Jr. went through a similar dilemma in facing folks like Bull Connor in Birmingham, but he chose another way. While he challenged the governmental structures, calling those in power to account for their injustice, he did so in a way that upheld the call to love, honor, and humility. His followers would stand up for their rights, experiencing the worst that hate would throw at them, and stand back up in love and dignity. In many ways, these saints took the path of Jesus himself, the one who never lashed out in the face of his impending death, even as he was being led to the cross. What we can't forget is that love must be at the heart of everything we do. It was true in the time before Jesus, the time when the prophet Micah said that God requires us to seek justice, love mercy, and walk in humility with God. And it's true today as we remember Jesus telling us that the center of the law, the core of our faith and practice, is centered on loving God and loving our neighbor. To be a person of faith is to know that love is at the center of all, and our goal for life is the pursuit of loving deeply. We haven't gotten there yet, but to follow Jesus is to engage in a work of transformation which leads to love. You didn't mince words about this when, in the section just before the center of our conversation today, you called the Roman Church to love. Love from the center of who you are, you wrote. Don't fake it. Run for dear life from evil. Hold on for dear life to good. Be good friends who love deeply. Practice playing second fiddle. Don't burn out. Keep yourselves fueled and aflame. Be alert, servants of the Master, cheerfully expectant. Don't quit in hard times. Pray all the harder. Help needy Christians. Be inventive in hospitality. Bless your enemies. No cursing under your breath. Laugh with your happy friends when they're happy. Share tears when they're down. Get along with each other. Don't be stuck up. Make friends with nobodies. Don't be the great somebody. Don't hit back. Discover beauty in everyone. If you've got it in you, get along with everybody. Don't insist on getting even. That's not for you to do. I'll do the judging, God says. I'll take care of it. Our scriptures tell us that if you see your enemy hungry, go buy that person lunch, or if he's thirsty, get him a drink. Your generosity will surprise him with goodness. Don't let evil get the best of you. Get the best of evil by doing good. It's that call to love that guides us in our political dealings. Yes, we are cynical today, not quite trusting our political authorities due to years of seeing power misused. But we still love them, and we wish the best for them. Yes, we worry that some might bring harm to this place, but we pray for them and ask God to guide them in doing the right thing. To be a follower of Jesus is to know that love is at the core of all we do, and that love guides every action and every decision, from how we live our lives, to the issues we support, to the selection of our leaders. Dearest Paul, you are an example of that for us. You sit today in Corinth, but in a few short months you will be in a Roman jail for preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. You will be tortured and eventually taken to Rome, where tradition tells us you were killed by Nero for your faith. And yet, even in jail, you experienced the joy of life in Christ and prayed for those who imprisoned you. Your life was filled with love for these authorities, even when they did bad things to you, and you provided a model for us to emulate. So we sit here today, thousands of years after you wrote your letter to the Romans, writing a letter back to you. If you're hanging around in the heavenly Rome with Jesus, let him know we need his help, for your teaching is sometimes hard. Let him know that we sometimes fail in our love, and that we rebel at submitting ourselves to others. Let him know that we need to be so filled with love that all the world, secular and religious, will know of his amazing grace. Thanks for your words. May we live them into being. Sincerely, Jay.
As a child of the light, I want to follow Jesus. God set the stars to give light to the world. The star of my life is Jesus. In him there is no darkness at all. The night and the day are both alike. The Lamb is the light of the city of God. Shine in my heart, Lord Jesus. I want to see the brightness of God. I want to look at Jesus. Clear sun of righteousness, shine on my path and show me the way to the Father. In him there is no darkness at all. The night and the day are both alike. The Lamb is the light of the city of God. Shine in my heart, Lord Jesus. Jesus. I'm looking for the coming of Christ. I want to be with Jesus. When we have run with patience the race, we shall know the joy of Jesus. In him there is no darkness at all. The night and the day are both alike. The Lamb is the light of the city of God. Shine in my heart, Lord Jesus.
So I know today's sermon was a little bit different than what I've been doing in the past. But I hope that it will stir some thoughts for you about the place of government in your life and your relationship to it. And those questions really influence how we make decisions about who will lead us. The vision that we have for our nation and for our state and for our city. I don't claim to have any great answers for how we make those decisions. But I do know that love must be at the center of everything we do. As we wrap up, I don't have a lot of announcements, but one of the ways that we express that love is through helping our neighbors. And we're doing that tonight, October 25th, through our community meal, our feast. Tonight at 5:00, people will show up at the door, and there'll be all races and ethnicities. They will be from a variety of backgrounds and political affiliations and economic statuses. And we will hand them a meal and say, we give you this with the love of Jesus. If you want to come help us do that, show up around 4:00 tonight at the church, and we will pack meals and then serve them to folks who need them. Another way that we offer God's love is through prayer. And we are made aware of, on a regular basis, the needs of our neighbors and our friends, folks in the community that need prayer. And so as they begin to scroll by on the screen in just a moment, I invite you to take these names and lift them up to God and ask for God to show God's love to every situation.
Let us pray. O Lord our God, creator and ruler of all creation, we come as a people who are and will be making decisions about who should lead us. Help us to move beyond partisan bickering and to think carefully about the role of governance in your kingdom and how our leaders can be instruments of peace, justice, and love. Give us your total and complete wisdom, so that we will be a people who are working together to bring forth your kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven. As your servant Paul reminded us, may we never forget that love is the fulfillment of the law. Help us to love one another, even when we don't want to. And help us to love all of our neighbors, those in our church and those on the outside, those who look like us and those who don't, those who are living a comfortable life, and those for whom life is a day-to-day struggle. May we radiate your love so much that broken hearts will be healed, that demons will be sent away, that the hungry will be fed, and the sick and imprisoned comforted. Jesus, we come before you today, remembering that you took the form of a servant, humbling yourself to the point of death, so that all the world might be redeemed, and light would shine in the darkness. It's in your honor and memory that we pray together the prayer you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Again, may God keep.